Welcome back for episode 46 of Focus Fire Chat, recorded live on August 23rd, 2016 on twitch.tv. A big shout out to the chat here. Thank you so much for spending your evening with us. This is your host, Blue Crew 86. Alongside me, we have the man who it has been said has the voice of a flower, Justin Sane 0516.
What's up, guys?
Next up is the third member of our merry little band, our friendly neighborhood spokesman for pain, Steamin' Willy Beeman.
Brought to you by Full Throttle.
We also have WindoftheStars, or as we know her, Mel, back. Mel, how's it been?
It's been good, just doing cosplay stuff, and I'm excited to talk about one of my favorite topics today. How to say that.
Belle had something come up that prevented her from joining us tonight, but we're hoping to have her join us again sometime soon. But the topic of tonight's chat is going to be a look at the lore of the Awoken. Before we get into that, however, I did want to run through some quick notes. Our last chat, we took a look at the lore of the King's Fall Raid. If you missed that and have any interest in hearing our thoughts, please be sure to check out www.focusfirechat.com for archives of all previous chats, as well as links to all our various other pages. If you don't mind, please give us some feedback on iTunes as well to let us know how we're doing. As many of you already know, Focus Fire Chat is a cross-community gathering where the intent is to offer a week-long, in-depth view of a particular subject from within the lore of Destiny and other games. This chat begins every Tuesday morning and runs until the following Tuesday, with topics decided by the group via a poll that begins every Friday and ends on the Tuesday morning of the new chat. Every Wednesday at about 10 p.m. Central, we get together to stream a recap of the previous week's chat for those who are unable to participate. We have also officially joined the Guardian Radio Network. If you're not already listening to the podcast over on the guardiansofdestiny.com, fix that immediately. Guardian Radio and Guardian One are amazing groups, and we're truly honored to join them. Our next chat's going to be a discussion on the lore of sword logic. With that, let's go ahead and dive into the information that we have about those who dwell at the edge of the darkness, the last place the light touches, the Awoken.
Well, I think we're going to end up getting a lot more about the Awoken because I think we've had some discussions on it before. We're probably going to get a little bit more in depth now with what we have. And we have some on the Guardian Races card, Awoken. We have a quote that says, "The others sing this song of light and dark. We, together, have transcended such unimaginative limitations. It is said that the Awoken were born in the collapse, descended from those who try to flee its wrath. Something happened to them out on the edge of the deep black, and they were forever changed. Today, many Awoken live in the distant reef, aloof and mysterious, but others return to Earth, where the descendants now fight for the city. Earthborn Awoken who venture out to the reef, hoping to learn its secrets, find no special welcome from the reclusive queen." Which, on that note, I'm going to say that when I started my Awoken Guardian, and they're still like, you know, they pull you over on Vanilla Destiny, and they're like, you follow us or you die. I was like, what the hell? I'm Awoken. I'm one of you. And when you actually get into the Destiny lore, you find out why. Anybody else have thoughts on that one?
Yeah, I know from one of the GDC panels, just real quick, another basic look at the Awoken is from Joe Staton and Christopher Barrett. They described the Awoken as being a beautiful, exotic, and mysterious, and it was kind of modeled off of elves, vampires, ghosts, and angels. And the quote that they used was that was to capture that exotic sort of ethereal feel. So that's where the sense of that, you know, elven-esque nature of the Awoken that a lot of people attribute to. I know a lot of times in the chat, it was made comment that they always are viewed as kind of an elven race. You know, they're kind of apart. They're not part of the drama of the Traveler and the tower and all that. So that's where
we're like Khajiit.
There's a lot of parallels to be drawn there too. With Tolkien elves.
Yeah, and that's
selectively intervene when it's, you know, when it suits them.
Right. And the emphasis on that too, because it's when it suits them and it's determined by them, not by it doesn't make sense what drives their involvement.
Yeah, I would agree with that. So we actually do have a ghost fragment on the Awoken. Ghost fragment Awoken. And these are reports from a derelict vessel boarded in the first known voyage to the reef. 1,100 meter length, active gravity generation, residual heat, fast neutron scatter, designation code corrupted, date of commissioning unknown, origin point unknown, presumed to have collided / merged with 1 kilometer comet. Assessment based on the depth of the hydrocarbon crust covering the hull. Water content of soil, atmosphere of oxygen and carbon dioxide with isotopic ratios placing the comet in the Oort population. Low-light foliage grown from terrestrial stocks, mirrors focusing starlight into growth chambers, resident fauna, 5 insect species plus rats descended from uncertain ancestors. Surface, heavily wooded until recently unknown event triggering firestorm. 70% of the world forest consumed. Atmosphere laced with smoke and particulates. Free oxygen in short supply. No distress calls noted. No evidence of crew or passengers on exterior. Interior scans inconclusive. Cleared to attempt approach. Yeah, this is a very vague card.
Well, and I know we kind of talked about it a little bit in the chat too, but the comet of the Oort population, if I remember this correctly, again, as everyone knows, wow. I am not an astronomer, but I think this is in regards to the Oort cloud. Which is actually a cloud of, if I remember right, it's a cloud of like ice and other objects of that nature, but it's actually well past the heliopause. It's well past pretty much everything. And I want to say it is, let me just pull up a definition real quick. You got it. Okay, cool.
Yeah. The Oort cloud, and I don't know if I'm pronouncing that correctly because it's Dutch, but the Oort cloud is an extended shell of icy objects that exist in the outermost reaches of the solar system. It is named after the astronomer Jan Oort, who first theorized its existence. The Oort cloud is roughly spherical and is thought to be the origin of most of the long period comets that have been observed.
And pins just threw that into the chat too. So,
yay!
Yeah. So basically, when it says that it is believed its isotopic ratio is placing the comet in the Oort population, it's basically saying, hey, this comet came from the Oort cloud, which, you know, like you just said, it's the origin of most of the long period comets that have been observed. So, I think another note on the supposed Oort cloud is the outer limit defines the cosmographical boundary of the solar system and what's called the extent of the sun's hill sphere. The point of that is that the outer reaches of the cloud are actually only very loosely bound to our solar system. So there are theoretically easy exchanges from the passing of stars and actually within the Milky Way itself, which is why sometimes we'll see comets, because that's basically those forces dislodging comets from the orbits within the cloud and careening them into our solar or the inner solar system. So, but I mean, that's, yeah. I mean, other than that.
So I was going to speak to how far out the Oort cloud was. It ends roughly 100,000 astronomical units from the sun. An astronomical unit is a unit of measurement roughly equal to 149.6 million kilometers, which is the mean distance from the center of the Earth to the center of the sun. So 100,000 of those.
It's very, 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 that, very, very far.
Not to bore with science. Please move on.
Another thing we'll get into when we start talking about the reef is the idea of how exactly the reef is made. And the point that I'm bringing here is the comment that it says presumed to have collided or merged with a comet. Keep that in mind for when we get to the reef and how the reef has been formed, because that's another nod here to what is going on in this area of space. But I think that's everything. I mean other than the really interesting surface was heavily wooded until Firestar.
This is a ship, right?
Yes.
I mean, I think we can all agree on that, right? And they've grown plants and stuff with hydroponics, I'm assuming.
Yeah, and I mean, I honestly picture the Doctor Who ship from one of the Weeping Angels. Well, there's a scene within one of the Doctor Who episodes where they're walking through a spaceship that has a forest that is been basically grown on the ship with the intent to help provide oxygen for the crew. And so it's kind of a natural filtration system. And that's kind of how I picture.
Yeah, so this was probably a Golden Age escape ship.
Mm-hmm. That was... Well, and also note, we don't know when... So we know that this is the first known voyage to the reef, which obviously it's not the first voyage because we're finding ships. So, yeah. But yeah, I think that's pretty much. Mel, Willy, do you guys have anything to?
Nope.
No. I was about to say that you guys pretty much covered all of that.
You guys are very thorough.
Only thing I have to add is Merca. That's about it.
Yeah, and I mean, and the other thing is no evidence of crew or passengers from the exterior scan, and there's no distress calls. So, yeah.
So, America.
But, so Ghost, so you want to take, Mel, you want to grab the next Ghost Fragment?
I can do that. So, this is Ghost Fragment, Awoken 2. I was nothingness. If I existed before, I existed as a possibility, as potential, stretched thin across the aether. And maybe there was a body that looked like my body, complete with a soul that could be confused for someone rather than like me. What I am now is not real, and then I was born, and the universe was free to begin. Others were present at my birth. A great ceremony had just begun. Because newborns are selfish beasts, I assumed I was the object of attention. I didn't notice the singing until the singers fell silent, and then she appeared. She was above me, ethereal and handsome and elegant. I assumed my face was like her face, and that odd idea gave me strength enough to smile. Secrets, she said. Creation is built on secrets, and the encryptions that keep those secrets safe. I made my first sound. It meant nothing, but she understood it as a question. We are beautiful creation, she said. And we must keep ourselves very safe. That's it.
So,
obviously, it's a good card.
It's a great card.
I kind of interpreted that as this is an Awoken obviously being born in the reef area, if they're in the reef at this point, because we don't even know when this takes place. But does anyone get the kind of impression that maybe this is the queen or someone that is within her inner circle that is there? I don't know. This seems a very important thing. So
it's very important because this is an awoken being born. Mm-hmm. Now, the question we have here is this an awoken being born from, like, you know, because we as humans, we start out as babies and we eventually grow into adults. Whereas awoken, they have a completely different version of birth. Like, for them, birth is them going from human to awoken for people mm-hmm. like Mara and the Crow. Right. So whether this is her being born from an adult human to an adult woken, or, you know, just being born in general as an awoken baby, or maybe even awoken aren't born as babies at all. Maybe they're just born as adults. We don't have a confirmation of that as of right now. Personally, I lean more toward her being an adult right now. Like, I see that kind of like a glimpse into what it was like for those, especially with the last card, talking about how there was no, you know, talking about the ship, how mm-hmm. there's no signs of asking for help or there's just no crew. I kind of see this as early where the awoken were first born as awoken mm-hmm. and her being an adult being, you know, she was transformed into awoken. She does not know what's going on, but, you know, as we have found out about the awoken, whether or not we know how they're born exactly, we know that not all of them know their birth. Not a lot of them remember their birth. And we'll get into that later, I'm sure.
Mm-hmm.
But this awoken here is talking about her birth into the awoken world. Go ahead.
Right. I kind of always, in my head canon, imagine the first awoken were obviously became awoken. Like, you're not born into one, but I would like to think that once the, I guess, species kind of evolved more, then it was something like, oh, okay, you can create an awoken, like two people that are awoken can create. But the fact that they're called awoken, it makes me think like, okay, they're obviously awoken from some state. Otherwise, why would they be called, you know, like, that's the name that they're called, to me, always is very telltale of what they are too, you know. So, because obviously here she's very much saying like, hey, I was nothing, I was pretty much dead. It's what I kind of read from this card, is that she was basically nothing, and then at this point she was awoken into her new state of being, just like you were saying, Willy.
Yeah, that's exactly what I was trying to say. Like, she's probably an adult that had died. But once again, that's where things flipped for when we actually had the Awoken created, as was mentioned early on, mm-hmm. is where they were trying to flee from the darkness on Earth, and they were caught out there in between the dark and the light, mm-hmm. which is why Mara tells the Kell of Wolves, the light is my mother and the dark is my father.
Exactly.
And that's a good reason why they would be called the Awoken, because we've had this conversation on this podcast, you know, that the dark and the light are two sides of the same coin, possibly. Mm-hmm. So with them being caught in the middle, they would probably be the most awake out of all of us.
Right. They're able to see both sides. They can almost be considered, probably to a degree, an enlightened species, that they're able to see both sides for their good and their bad sides. So
I agree completely.
So go for it, Justin. Go for it.
I was just gonna say I've got kind of a little bit more of a pragmatic breakdown on the way I see the Awoken. If, when they were fleeing the darkness and whatever happened, whether you want to call it a gamma burst or whatever it is that changed them forever, space magic, I don't care. I think that what happened to them, I mean, you can get all, you know, magical and fantastical with it, but I think what happened to them is a lot like a genetic mutation. And I think in that moment when the Awoken were first born, you know, when I say born, I'm saying figuratively, because they were obviously people already. But that was just an acquired genetic mutation in response to whatever it was that, you know, mutated them. But then it doesn't say the nature of Awoken reproduction anywhere. Mm-hmm. I would love it if it would. But I love it that Mel has a head cannon. I think that's awesome. But, I'm just picturing a gun on your, never mind. But, but so I think everything from that moment on is a hereditary mutation. So right. you've got the event that happens that changes their, you know, that group of people that, you know, that group.
It's an awakening.
And then you could call it that, but really scientifically it's just a mutation. They just became mutated. And then as they reproduced, hopefully they can reproduce. I'd like to think that every Awoken loss isn't irreplaceable. You know what I mean? Like that mm-hmm. as a story, as a plot point, that would really stick, you know?
Right.
Because
right.
there were a bunch lost. So if we believe that they can, yes, they can reproduce and they can produce offspring, whether it's done in the manner of humans, which they started out as, or some other way, everything from that point on becomes a hereditary mutation.
Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, Blaine, you can go ahead.
You know, I was just going to, I have a couple points. First off, we do know, I mean, I'm going to double down on the hereditary mutation, because we know from the Awoken card that there are descendants. Now, yeah. The question of the reproduction is one that honestly Dragon and I have gone around and around on before. I mean, we've gone back and forth on this a number of times, but we both agree there is reproductive capabilities on the Awoken species, because there is multiple mentions of descendants for both Reefborn and Earthborn. And you wouldn't call. So I'm going to kind of go a little bit. I'm going to pull in a little bit of information out from a couple other fantasy series. So you have things like Shadowrun. You have things like pretty much any postmodern fantasy series out there. The Dresden Files, the Chronicles of Shannara, the Vampire Diaries, not Vampire Diaries, the Vampire Earth. Why did I say that? The Vampire Earth series. I was thinking something and yeah. Anyways. All of the postmodern fantasy series follow this very common thing that kind of stems from an idea that I think if I want to say Shadowrun kind of initiated, but basically what happens is an event occurs within human history or the human involvement, and it fragments the genetic makeup, which allows these separate races to become mutations from the base human genome. And that in a lot of these fantasy series actually refer to this as an awakening of the human genome. It's an awakening of these elements, you know, via mutation, via whatever, you know, stressor out there. And if you're thinking about it like that, and again, if you look at the Awoken as being kind of based off the elven archetype, it would make a lot of sense that if they are a genetic mutation, like what you're saying, that's exactly what happened. Is their DNA was awoken from this trauma, and they became the Awoken. Then once that initial splinter happens, you know, everything after that is right. It would be a hereditary passing on of the traits, just like any, you know, evolutionary tract would go. But that's exactly what happens with mutations, is that sudden mutation happens and then it's passed on if they survive, which they have. The other thing is you wouldn't call them Reefborn or Earthborn if you don't have a process of birth. You know, now whether or not that birth is a natural birth, like a human, you know, like the natural process of human procreation, or if it's a ceremony that, you know, you take whatever. I mean, there's a lot of ways to look at this particular card, But the other thing is you have to keep in mind is that the other cards reference those Earthborn and Reefborn. And, you know, I can see this maybe being a mutation of spiritual nature that they take an adult human and convert them into an adult Awoken if it was just Reefborn. But the fact is that we also have Earthborn. And I don't really see a lot of humans in the city being completely okay with being converted to Awoken when there's not a lot of humans left. You know, I get the sense that there might be a little bit of animosity towards the Earthborn Awoken if they were converting humans into Awoken in that nature.
Yeah, it's not
right?
a religion, it's a race.
Well, you know? But I mean, but you would have a genocide. Like you would, because the humanity is on the brink of extinction, and then all of a sudden you have this other species that's like literally hijacking your species. There's a survival nature, there's a survival trait there that's gonna get Awoken, no pun intended there, that's gonna get brought up between humanity and the Awoken, and that tension, as far as we know, doesn't exist. Which makes me really, really strongly think that it's a natural form of procreation. Now that initial genetic mutation's out of the way, it's now all hereditary. The other point here is that the comment of secrets. Now, a lot of people, there's a lot of different ways to take this. A lot of people have the theory that this is a nod to Savathun, and that this is a potential, you know, connection here between the Awoken species and one of the three siblings of the Hive. The other possible thing here is, remember what the Awoken are famous for. Cryptography, or cryptology. So they are the trainers of all the cryptarchs that we encounter within the game. Every single cryptarch
all the cryptarchs.
That's what I was just about to say. Every cryptarch that we've seen...
The one coming in Rise of Iron, she's going to be an Awoken as well, right?
Which makes perfect sense. Hygieia is the great library, or was the great library of all this information. And what are engrams? They're encryptions in pure matter to keep things secret and keep things safe. So creation is built on secrets, and the encryptions that keep those secrets safe. Creation is built on secrets, and engrams keep those secrets safe. The Awoken exist almost to protect secrets. Remember what they do with reframes. They don't allow them to get personalities. They scrub them religiously because they don't want information getting out. Their entire culture is based around secrets and the keeping of those secrets. And that is, you know, that is entirely the queen's persona. Is she is an enigma of her. I mean, the Awoken themselves are an engram, if you really want to carry this
out,
right? Whoa. And we don't have the decryption code to decrypt that engram. Hopefully by the end of the Destiny series we will have been able to, but I mean, think about it. Think how cryptarchs decrypt engrams. Also think who those cryptarchs are. They're all Awoken. What if the decryption process for engrams is built into their very genetic structure?
Yeah, they're all Awoken and they're all a wee bit snippy.
Well, and you know, and
don't
then
you
there's
talk
the
about my like that, okay?
Well, but there's the philosophical argument there too between the Tower cryptarchy and the Reef cryptarchy, which, you know, we talked about in depth. But I mean, that's entirely how I read this. Is this presents to me the Awoken species is an engram.
Don't
you talk about my girl Mara like that? Okay, she ain't no engram.
Very, very, very good analogy, Blue.
And I like it a lot because, far as I know, we haven't encountered any other species that has been successful in melding both the light and the dark. Like, the light and the dark have always been at odds with each other. So what if the actual Awoken are the answer to solving this life?
Exactly. Yeah. No, that's actually where I was going next. That was actually my next point is, you know, what if the final decryption is us figuring out what happened to the Awoken because they are the key to us unlocking our destiny as guardians.
Right.
Or how mad will Oryx be if he finds that the final shape is an engram?
He's not going to be mad at all because he's dead. We killed him already.
But he comes out blue.
So, I mean, that's just, you know, again, just my interpretation of this card, but.
Nice.
That got real heavy real fast.
Yeah, it did. I'm treading water.
That's what Blue does. He just drops a bomb and everybody's just like, well, wow. Didn't think about it that way before.
Yeah. You opened our eyes. Wow. I feel awoken now.
Oh, I know. It's so hard not to say that, too. It's like, I feel awake. Oh, damn. So... So Ghost Fragment Awoken 3. You want me to grab this one real quick?
I can do it. I don't care. I haven't pulled up.
Get out of her way. She's got it.
I have it pulled up. I got this covered. Okay. Ghost Fragment Awoken 3. Fear. Fear is the only vivid memory left in me. It's a moment when my fear was so thick and urgent that I gave up breathing. I stopped pretending to think. How I remained on my feet was a mystery because the terror was bearing down on me like a mountain about to crush my soul. But I have to ask, what was terrifying me? Darkness ruled the sky. The world around us had shattered and it seemed vanishing, unlike that we would outlive this one awful day. Yet the fear didn't come from the surrounding mayhem and despair. The source was inside my skin. I was utterly terrified of my own awful nature. And which part scared me? Inside me was an essence woven from beyond. Was I awoken before this? She was still in my head. I could hear her song growing fainter. Gone? Not yet. A new crippling terror was taking over. I was focused entirely on my fear, but I had to make an effort. And it occurred to me that nothing in the universe was more dangerous than human hubris. I still had this other within me, but the human side was what mattered, weak and foolhardy, sure to fail in the next moment. That's why I was afraid. Then someone spoke. Maybe it was me. I don't remember. I was trying to focus and a new thought took over me. My soul lay between those two entities, and that's how I still am. The boundary, the seam, the friction. I like it. That card.
That's a good one.
That's a really good one.
She's actually recalling, it seems like,
that moment, that specific moment, yeah, when she realized that she had darkness coming into her and she didn't understand it. But then she was like, wait a minute. This is good. There's new things granted to me because of this. But then she's also reflecting on her human nature. Her human's like, well, wait a minute, human nature, human light nature, you know, that light essence is also good because it helps keep me alive in a sense, you know, like they're sure to fall, but that's what's the essence of what makes me feel alive, mm-hmm, you know? So reading this was, I liked it a lot.
Yeah.
So,
because I mean, what is fear if not just a basic survival mechanism?
Right.
Too much fear can be a hindrance and can actually negatively impact your survival. Mm-hmm.
She was not afraid. Like, you can see this whole entire, you know, decrescendo down into like, oh my gosh, I'm scared of what I'm becoming. But then accepting that like, wait a minute, this isn't bad. But then, you know, being afraid of what she's no longer is, but then like, wait, I still am. And realizing, and I lost my train of thought. There you go. There you be. So hi guys.
I read this card as a Dune reference. I mean, and Justin, you'll probably follow me pretty quickly here, is the "I must not fear" quote. And the quote, for those who haven't read Dune, I would really suggest anyone who hasn't read Dune read it. But it, the quote is, "I must not fear. Fear is the mind killer. Fear is the little death that brings total obliteration. I will face my fear. I will permit it to pass over and through me. And when it has gone past, I will turn the inner eye to see its path. Where the fear has gone, there will be nothing. Only I will remain." And that's really, I mean, you're this entire card's talking about, you know, when the fear began to fade, and, you know, that's where this character is this boundary, this seam between these two entities, which, you know, you can argue a lot of places. Is this the human and the other? Is this the light? Is this the dark? What is it? Or is it all of them? You know, again, going back to my view of the Awoken as an engram, it almost seems like the Awoken themselves are still trying to figure out what exactly they are. You know, that what is it mean to be an Awoken? What does that bring to the table, if you would, for them? You know, they view human hubris, which is an extremely elven concept, but the view of the human side as weak and foolhardy and always sure to fail, that is where it's kind of like, you know, they exist within the mage in the chat. This is where they exist, is between that friction, between that tension between the light and the dark. You know, if you want to go so far as to call it good and evil, you can, but they exist in the shadows between those two. They are not either or, which also kind of explains to me, and at least in my head, it explains their standoffishness when it comes to the Guardians. But it also understand the depth of and the danger that the darkness threatens, which is why ultimately, you know, when we get when we get down to the card where Mara agrees to take on Oryx, that's where that kind of comes from. They understand what that means, what the Faustian bargain that the worm gods made, the true nature of that. They understand that because they exist on the brink. So, but yeah, this card screams the Dune quote to me.
And for people like myself who have not seen Dune, I agree with Wind on this one. It seems like, you know, because you also got to figure, once again, this also fuels into my timeline of being this kind of where the Awoken are first born, or at least close to it. I'm not saying that this is the first Awoken or anything like that, of course, but the people were fleeing Earth, obviously they were scared. We had the darkness coming. People were going to die. Everybody thought they might be one of them. And these people that got caught out here between the light and the dark during this battle, of course you're going to be scared. You know, you were just caught. You pretty much were pretty sure you're going to die. And then you wake up. Instead of being in death, you're this completely new species. Not only are you a completely new species, but you understand that they're the light and the dark, which is something that we as Guardians in game have not been able to do exactly yet. Yeah, I mean, we've read the Books of Sorrow. I don't know if I'm pretty sure that's supposed to be in game as well, you know, because you do get the Grimoire cards in game. So we understand the darkness to the point, I guess, kind of where the Hive do. But the Awoken have been directly affected by it. They have been smacked in the face on the right side of on the right cheek, while the light slapped them on the left cheek. And that's what made them what they are right now. And so I get the feeling that that's, once again, what they're leaning toward with these past couple cards. Actually, all three I might even go for. It just seems like Awoken Ghost Fragment 1, it seems like it's a more organized birth, you know, compared to 2 and 3.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think you could say that our knowledge of the darkness is academic, whereas the Awoken have an intimate understanding.
They got the street cred, you know? They've been there.
They've lived it.
They had to empty their pockets.
Yeah.
Where we haven't yet. That's what I was trying to say, Justin.
Take it to the streets, Willy.
Well,
so the hood. So are they like the hood rats of the Destiny?
Oh,
like, is that what you're trying to tell me?
No, those are thrall.
No.
Oh, those are thrall. Okay, all right.
I'm just kidding.
Oh, I have been.
Clicks and everything is like empty packets. What you got? But no, the Awoken. I feel part personally, you know, just from a lore aspect, that they're actually the most, well, specifically the Reefborn Awoken are the more knowledgeable out of probably any race in Destiny, like you said, Stars, right now.
Mm-hmm.
That they know the most just because, once again, they have felt the dark and the light at the same time. That's how they were made, at least the Reefborn. It seems like those of us that are Earthborn, you know, the Guardian versions, we don't even remember any of that like they do. Like the people out in the Reef have a specific heritage that they stand by no matter what. Whereas in the Earthborn Awoken that we are pretty much human or exo. You know, like your Guardian does the same thing no matter what. And I don't think that's just a game mechanic. That's just lore wise as well.
Mm-hmm.
If you were here on Earth,
but you're also looking at it. You're also looking at a different societal upbringing as well. You know, But I mean, just going back to Awoken too, the Reefborn are raised and bred and raised in an environment that they are secrets. Their job is to keep the secret or secrets, you know, whatever. But that's that, you know, again, like what we were talking about in the Cryptarch episode, that is the root of the difference in the philosophies between the Earthborn and the Reefborn Awoken. Is the Reefborn are 100% obsessed with not letting outsiders understand or know anything about their culture. And you know, we'll get there when we start talking about the asteroid belt and the Reef and stuff like that. Whereas someone from Earthborn, they've been raised in the tower. They've been raised in that society where it's, you know, the wolf pack, and they are brought up, and the group is better, you know, the group is a sum of its parts, and all this rhetoric that we kind of, even in reality, we would kind of associate more with. But whereas the Reef, I mean, the Reef is, well, let's talk about the Reef real quick. The Reef is a location within the asteroid belt, and that starts, you know, that's where we're going to start with this Grimoire card, is the asteroid belt. And there's the quote, "The belt is the key to everything." Keep that in mind. The asteroid belt is a great band of nothingness, speckled with an unimaginable wealth. Once a treasure trove for Golden Age industry, the belt is now a haunted place where fallen pirates and Awoken patrol skirmish along the whispering carcasses of ancient machines. Among the asteroids drift the Reef, lashed together from the ruined ships of an ancient exodus. Here the Queen rules over the Awoken, the farthest known light of civilization. Again, when you're dealing, your entire culture is based in this geography instead of the geography of Earth, which is, you know, for the most part, you can walk outside and you can probably still survive to a degree. Here, you walk outside, you die immediately because it's space. It's the vacuum of space. You have to rely on each other, and you have to keep that together. Whereas, you know, with the traveler heading, you know, hovering over the last city, there's a bit of wiggle room for dissent among the political parties of the city, Whereas here, there is no wiggle room. You wiggle too much, you break something. And if you break something in space, you all die. It's mm-hmm. And you know, that's where that kind of brutal ruthlessness of the Reefborn Awoken, I think, comes from. Is it's just a survival instinct. They band together because if they didn't band together, they wouldn't be here. I also like the fact that the belt is the key to everything, because that ties into my Awoken or an Engram theory, but I won't.
I thought you were going to go Men in Black with that, personally.
Hmm? That's what I was thinking, Men in Black.
Oh, God.
Thank you, Bill. I love you. Thank you. I'm not the only one.
You're not the only one. It's okay.
But, so, I mean, I was just going to say the geographical nature of the different societies, to me, is the basis of the difference in their approach to not only outsiders, but themselves as well. You know, they're very, you know, and again, going back to the view of the Awoken as this elven type archetype, it makes sense to me that is right there.
Mm-hmm.
I still see Khajiit did nothing. Khajiit is innocent of this crime. But I do see why you say elven, because they are one of them. Like, the Awoken seem to have powers. Well, specifically, Reefborn Awoken, that we do not possess. And is it every single one of them? No. But does the tower have Tekkun witches? Does the tower have the queen who can control Harbingers? No, this is something out there in the reef specifically. These people that were born out there found this technology, found out how to use it. And not only did he do that, but they have their own rituals. They have their own places within their own society that all of them just seem to fit. You know, like, we aren't told that, you know, someone's born, they take a look at them and say, this one's going to be a Tekkun. This one's just going to be a citizen. You know, throw that to the side. Let's get to the good ones. We don't have that exactly on paper or anything. But we do have the fact that those out there in the reef, they all have their roles. They play them well.
Mm-hmm.
Very well, I think.
Well, and, you know, like we're talking about the reef, and you want to grab the Grimoire card real quick before I make a...
Yeah, grab it. I've had it. And the thing about the reef card is it says places the asteroid belt. And here's that quote that I was trying to say earlier in Vanilla Destiny. It says, intruder bearing 127, you have crossed into the realm of the Awoken. State your business or be fired upon by order of the queen. And of course, we know they're talking about the great Marisol. I'd say late and great, but her voice actor kind of hinted to her coming back. The fate of those escaping Earth during the collapse was once unknown. But here drifts a graveyard of lost ships, and among them, the realm of the Awoken. Ruled by a queen few have seen, they have long avoided contact with the city. And we know why they avoided contact from the city with, I want to say we touched on it more than once. Like, accidentally, the one we go to now, Petrovenge, she might have murdered some guardians on accident. It's not like she was like, oh, who cares if the guardians are there? Well, actually, I guess that's exactly what she did. But in her defense, she thought that they could respawn, because that's kind of what we do. You know, we die and we come back. But the guard, and it's not a laughing matter. I'm sorry, but I just kind of picture Petra there. Like, yeah, go ahead and fire. Those guys will come back. Yep. Any minute now. The ghosts will be here and what? They're still not back? Houston, we have a problem. Like, that's what I picture when I think about that specific instance.
Right. So, and I think, but I think the distance that the reef has played within the city was actually, you know, even before then, because for the longest time, we didn't know the Awoken existed.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't really until, you know, they got involved with the whole thing with Six Fronts that we even really were aware of them. I mean, we kind of knew they were somewhere out there. We had no idea that, you know, what they really were, what they, you know, did, but they didn't. I mean, we kind of touched on that too, is, you know, they don't really get involved with stuff unless it benefits them or unless for some reason they cease. I don't know. It's, you know, until they find a point, they're not going to get involved in the game. And when they do get involved in the game, you know, they, even then, their involvement is steeped in secrets and mystery. So, mm-hmm. But I want to say, go for it.
I just wanted to make a note of where the reef actually was. It's actually in the asteroid belt, mm-hmm. which is a real place that we can actually pinpoint. And the asteroid belt exists between the orbits of Jupiter and Mars. And a lot of the notable asteroids in it are actually names from Awoken lore, like Ceres, Vesta, Pallas, Hygieia.
Mm-hmm. Amethyst. These are actually Amethyst. Real
places. Yeah, Amethyst. These are actual real celestial bodies that we can kind of use to pin down where all this is happening, which is, I like it when they do that.
Yeah, and the...
Yeah, it's really awesome how they use real life, like, place. I'm sorry, Blue.
No.
I was going to say it is really how they use, like, real life places out there in space that, you know, they're out there.
Right.
And they actually use these in game. I never knew these existed until I started digging into the Lord. Well, until all of us started digging into the Lord of Destiny. It's like, holy crap. Ceres? That's a real place? That's awesome. Yeah. Go ahead, Blue. What were you saying?
I was just going to say it's so big it was misidentified as a planet several times.
Yes. I was going to say the Vestian web is the heart of the reef, and that's built around asteroid 4 Vesta. These are just, I guess, real quick. These are the locations that we know of within the reef. From various different pieces. We have the Vestian Outpost, which is the military outpost that guards the entrance to the Queen's realm. The Vestian Web, which is the heart of the reef, which is, you know, what I just said, built around an asteroid labeled 4 Vesta. Amethyst, which used to exist. It was destroyed during the reef wars. Then we have 2 Pallas, which is an asteroid home to a major community of the Awoken. 10 Hygieia, which we talked about in our Cryptarch episode, that is the home of the largest division of the reef cryptarchy, and it actually was burned. As far as total destruction, we're not sure. It's kind of hinted at, but we're not 100% sure. And then the last one is 65 Sibel, which is a military fortress and was actually the site of the Sibel uprising that ended the reef wars. And I think that's everything. We do have the Vestian Outpost is centered around a asteroid that is labeled 5560 Amethyst. And I think that's everything that I know from the Grimoire. And yes, Hurt is putting in chat. The reef is basically a massive biodome, which, again, this is the part that I was saying, remember when we were talking about the Ghost Fragment Awoken card, when it says that the ship was presumed to have collided / merged with a comet. That's what this is. It's an artificial reef. If you think about it, we actually have these on Earth. We actually do this on Earth. We build artificial reefs in the ocean. Time. And that's what they're doing. They are building an artificial reef to catch things and to continue growing space. If they need more space, they theoretically can just, you know, build on the existing. So.
And that's, I mean, once again, we don't, the biggest thing about Destiny lore right now is the fact that this is the first couple of years, the first game. So we are only just learning the beginnings of a lot of things. But this is a reef that we didn't mean to create. It seems like from all the lore cards that we have, these people were genuinely just trying to escape, which makes you wonder, you know, like, how did Mara become the queen? What made her the queen of the Awoken? Was she the first one that was hit by the dark and the light? Or was she the first one hit by the dark and then the light caught up with her? So because she was hit by the dark first, that makes her the queen? We don't know answers to all of these questions yet, but we have the geography pretty much pinned down, I think.
Yeah, I was going to say the ghost. We have a couple ghost fragments that give us a little bit more detail about that. But I think, Justin, you want to grab before we go in, because I'm thinking ghost fragment Fallen 4. But I think the better introduction to these more specific fragments would be to talk about the queen, right? To introduce the queen.
Awoken. Certainly isn't her brother. Let's see. The queen. I love this. This is my favorite quote about the Awoken. I am noble too, O Lord of Wolves. Starlight was my mother, and my father was the dark. Queen of the Awoken is as much an enigma as the reef she rules. It is said that she won her crown through ruthlessness and that she stands as master of the fallen House of Wolves in place of their defeated Kel. The city's rise spells an end to the reef's age of isolation. The queen will surely look to this new era as an opportunity, and the city, in turn, must look to her. The reef-born Awoken has spent long ages out on the edge of everything, and they may know the secrets of terrible weight, the queen most of all.
That's a great card, by the way.
Yeah.
I'm going to throw that in there before I throw any theories in there, because I'm going to let someone else go first.
Isn't that the quote at the beginning? I am noble too, O Lord of Wolves. Starlight was my mother. My father was the dark.
Yeah, it's in the Madrid. When she first.
Oh, God.
God bless America. Come on, Justin. Point is it was in there, and yes, that is what Mara says to the Kell of the Wolves, mm-hmm. pretty much right before they
in one of the House of Wolves teasers, was it not?
It was not.
I don't think that necessarily quote was off the top of my head. I do know that the ghost fragment Fallen 4 has that quote.
Yes, it does, and I have that right here if you want me to go for it.
Yeah. Go for it.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
All right. It's the scatter. This happens long ago, but not too long to matter. Ceres rules the asteroid belt. Ceres is the white queen of this space. 400 million kilometers from the sun. Ceres is round. Round means power. Out here, nothing else in the belt is big enough to crush itself into a sphere with its own gravity. Ceres has its own chemical stars. Shavings of salt and ice that glint in orbit, like a crown. There are other lights, newer stars, newer crowns, warship engines. Another queen is coming to conquer Ceres, because Ceres is full of warrens and shipyards and habitats. Because Ceres is round and lucky as a servitor. Because Ceres is full of wolves, she wants to rule. Shark-fierce ships gather in the squadrons and tribes, skiffs, catches. The Kell of Wolves has fleet gathered here. The Kell of Wolves heard the call. He summoned the House of Wolves to prepare for the great battle on Earth. The salvation of the Kell's people depends on the ability to shatter the city. It's a matter of survival. Now the wolf fleet turns to meet the queen.
See the squadrons of skiffs wrapping themselves in stealth, cold and transparent, knifing out invisible and brave. See the catches like broad blades and the bright thoughts of a servitor guiding them to battle. See them turning, accelerating, waking up their jammers and their arc guns. All right, either way, this is pretty much, I'm not going to read this whole card because it's really long. But it's talking about how when the Wolf Fleet first goes to meet the Queen, I will go to where they actually talk to each other, though. So it's talking about how they're bracing themselves to fight the Awoken army. And when it gets down to it, the Kel finally decides he can win decisive. Like, he's really cocky about winning. He's figuring there's no way in hell this woman, this Awoken queen, as she calls herself, is going to win. And that's coming from his mind. And he says, "I am Lord of Wolves. You are an empty thing with two dead souls. This is my house. These are my terms. Surrender, and I will only take your ships." And at that point, the Awoken fleet cuts their engines. They drift. The Wolves strike elements, torpedo-armed skiffs. They hide under jamming camouflage, you know. And then the Queen, she responds, "I am noble too, O Lord of Wolves." And once again, the Kel's feeling cocky. He tells her, "You have no line. You have no power." And all the House of Wolves feel like they're ready at war. And that's when Mara says that line that was at the beginning of the other card. "Starlight was my mother, and my father was the dark." And in between that, you know, the servers are picking up something strange. And the Kel, he starts getting scared, but he still tells her, "Call on them then and see what help they offer." And she calls on the God bless America, help me here, guys. The Harbingers. I looked at the end of the card. And just tears them apart. And the Harbingers are still a really big mystery for us right now. We know they're Golden Age tech. But if they're Golden Age tech that was built on Earth and then sent out into the far out here in the reef, or we don't really know. And we don't even know if these things are sentient yet. It kind of feels like they are, but I don't think we know for sure if they are or aren't yet. But we do know that Mara controls them, and she absolutely destroys the Kella Wolves. I want to say she takes out their servitor right here, or at least a few, because it was a pretty big house. Anyone else thoughts?
Well, this is, I mean, so we have a couple nods here to the exact nature of her ability as well. It's not just the manifestation of a material weapon. It's also a somewhat EMP based weapon as well, because, you know, her entire communication is through radio burst. And you also get a nod here, you know, somewhat on the Fallen note here, that you get a nod that the servitors are able to taste things in the void. The void being here, I'm pretty confident the void is not meaning the void, the elemental nature of the void, but the void of space. They actually taste the space, and that's how they, you know, that's how they navigate. Kind of the way I picture it is, a servitor is kind of like a shark. It smells its way through. It tracks and scents and stuff like that. And so they are viewing this as a manifestation and a rippling of that space. And when she calls the Harbingers, you get a sense that it's not, like I said, it's not just a rocket. It's not just a plasma blast. It's a total, across the board, assault. You see you know, it says every servitor in the every catch hears it. Every captain and baron roars at their underlings as sensors go blind, firing solutions falter, and reactors stutter. The power systems hum with induction. Stealth fails. Space warps. And basically what that means is that she's not just summoning a weapon. She's also messing with everything else. So it's not just an assault. It's also a defensive measure as well. And, you know, we also learn later on that, you know, within the reforce, we learn that she is actually capable of doing massive illusions on top of this. She, later on in the reforce, she tricks the Fallen into thinking that she's going to do a repeat attack of what she does right here on one of their asteroids. And she panics them so much with this illusion that she actually tricks them into revealing themselves, and then has her Armada sweep in and just mop them up. The other thing here too is
that's
this
a good
kind
point,
of
Blue.
What was that?
I was just saying that's a good point.
Oh yeah.
That was a really important detail to throw in there. That,
right.
You know, everything goes silent on them. You know, it's like you said, a big EMP blast. So. On that note, go for it.
Right. And the other thing here too is that we don't really get the sense here, but she has a coven of entities called Tetchuans. And we're gonna talk about them later because they are a fascinating aspect within the hierarchy of the Awoken. The thing that if you haven't picked up on the Awoken by now is that it is a matriarch. It is a female led society, which we will, you know, when we get to her brother, we're gonna talk about the exact implications of that. But, I think the big thing for this card is that it's the point that the Awoken don't have to have a giant fleet to bring it to your knees. They have a queen and they have,
and space magic.
Yeah, they have space magic. And the thing about space magic is it's a really, really, really big gun. So it does. You don't have to have a lot of ships to make it an even fight. But that's really the impact of this entire banter between the queen and the former Kel of Wolves is it kind of also sets it up where you kind of get a sense of her personality really here. And, you know, that leads us into the ghost fragment, the queen. Mel, do you have that one pulled up for us?
Yes, I do.
Sweet. This one actually brings us into more of a personal setting for the queen.
Okay. Ghost fragment, the queen. For a while, the only lights were the eyes of the witches tending to the cell. The drone of the soul machines echoed through the prison, gas billowed and embedded in the shadows. She entered. They scurried to the points around her, the method of their arrangement precise. The Archon priest has been retired, my queen, said the witch to her right. Far from throne and audience, she moved without fear. Any word of Calchas Prime? We still sense something among the Anakins. The voice came from behind her. She did not turn to acknowledge it. For the span of a brief silence, she moved between the sealed cells of the wolf nobility with her witches in constellation around her. More of your brother's crows have entered the cauldrons of Rhea. The witch directly before her spoke with a dry buzz. The nine do not approve. She stopped a moment to study the sealed face of the cell. The cloud of her breath mingled with a slow exhalation of cryonics. Yes, cryonics. Send them one of our prizes, something to commemorate our mutual victory. And which of your prisoners would you gift? If she paused to think, if it only for an instant, send them Skolas, a lovely gesture. She cocked her head as if listening for a frozen heartbeat, and reminded him this. The crows are mine. That's a really good card as well.
There's not that many bad ones in this category.
that whole entire exhalation of Chronix, like just that sense of like this cold, icy, but calculating type of demeanor is very, that was a very good choosing of vocabulary there in that card.
I also like the nod that they give when, you know, near the beginning where she's like far, because she's not in the throne room and she doesn't have anybody other than the coven, she's moving without theater. She doesn't waste her energy, basically. Mm-hmm. And I like that that sense that, you know, she's two-faced, and not in a bad sense. She's a politician. She's a queen.
Oh yeah.
You know, and this is really kind of driving home everything that we hear from her, drives home that point.
Mm-hmm.
I also love the last comment of, yeah, that's nice. They're mine.
Yeah.
So, I had to figure out, it took a little bit, to what they're talking about, the Ananke's. And that's actually a group of you can't even really call them moons, but it's a group of irregular satellites that circle Jupiter. There's a full-blown Jupiter Jovian moon called Ananke. But the Ananke's plural is actually the group of little, planetoid things that accompanies that moon. So pretty much he's saying they're looking for Calyx Prime, and they say we sent something out towards Jupiter, and she pretty much ignores him. she's operating on a different plane. She might have, you know, I go back to that quote about Ikora, where Kate says, sometimes I feel like she's giving me, or what percentage of her attention is she giving, or of her mind is she spending on me right now? That's
what I'm from. Another geographic mention here is the Cauldrons of Rhea. Cauldrons of Rhea is, I'm pretty sure, is referring to a moon of Saturn, and that is Rhea. And apparently, it's creature. What's that?
Either that or an emu-like creature. That's like a cauldron. I don't know. All I'm getting.
It's the second largest moon of Saturn, and the ninth largest moon in the solar system, which again, number nine. It is the second smallest body in the solar system after the asteroid Ceres, which, we, if you remember, Ceres was destroyed. And so, and also apparently the Cauldron of Rhea is associated with the nine in some capacity, other than being, you know, the ninth largest moon. I can go into the historical and the mythological connection between the Titan Rhea, but I don't think we need to.
Wow. Look at Blue passing up a mythological chance.
I'm trying to be nice.
I'm impressed.
Blue, I clap for you right now, Blue. Like, I'm amazed.
So, Blue, do you have the second ghost fragment on the queen?
I do. So this one is, this is an awesome one. All right, so ghost fragment, the queen two. You don't have one. The hunter came to a halt in front of the throne, raised her covered face to meet the prince's gaze. No, she agreed. My next death will be my last. I know the feeling, the prince said dryly. The queen kept her expression carefully distant. She sat reclined in her throne, legs crossed, surveying the two figures at the base of the steps. Beside her, where the Wolves Guard used to stand, Tetsuin Shiro and Sadia hovered instead, their jewel-like augments gently humming. To her right, and just before, stood the prince, facing forward but his body half turned back toward her. "Your grace," said the man before her at the foot of the stairs. His voice was soft but strong. When he spoke, the hunter started to turn her head toward him, then flinched as if someone had shone a bright light into her eyes. "Thank you for your gracious welcome," he said. The queen inclined her head slightly. "Before we begin," spoke out the hunter, "I will say this." She paused, her head tilted up to the throne. The queen waved her hand in assent. The hunter's pale lips tightened slightly, then resumed their usual stony mien. "Your grace," she said. Shiro and Sidia shifted, a sudden rustling and whispering. The queen raised one finger to silence them. Aldrin's eyes narrowed, but he said nothing. "I am not here for you." The queen stared at the hunter, her expression studiously unchanged. "I have no wish to play politics. I have no grievance with the city. Not anymore. I have no grand hopes to end the war. For long have I known I will not see its end. I am here for one battle, and one alone. Because it is a battle we must all fight, together or separately. So I will warn the defenders, together or separately. I will do anything," her low voice shook with passion, "to end Oryx." A silence rang out in the room. The hunter kept her head raised, her ambiguous gaze directed at the shadows in the throne where the queen reclined. Then a small smile curved the queen's lip. "Well said," she straightened and leaned slightly forward so the room's light fell on her face. "So let us end him."
Such a good card.
I think we can probably spend an hour on what three people are in this.
Oh God, we already spent hours on who this is. Let's all just be bluntly honest. We spent hours discussing who one of these people is because everyone else is pretty obvious.
Yeah, one pretty bright person.
Yeah.
I want to
hear, who does Mel think it is? The man in this conversation.
The man?
Very bright man.
Are you talking about the hunter, or is that what you're talking about?
No, the hunter, other.
I think we all believe that to be Eris.
Oh, yeah. That's why I was kind of thinking it might be as well. But who are you asking? I think is the other
mystery person, the one with a soft but strong voice.
Yeah, who the hunter can barely look at.
I mean, you could almost say that his voice was like a flower.
Oh, you can't. You're putting me on the spot here.
I was thinking a lot of it.
Oh. That would make sense. I didn't think of. Yeah. Yeah. Now you mentioned. Yeah. Yeah.
Who? I mean,
Now that you said it, it's like, well, considering that, you know, that they're working with the reef and blah, 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 blah. Mm-hmm. And, you know, all this other stuff, that it makes sense that it would be him. I don't know who else off the top of my head it would be and why he would be there.
Right. Yeah.
So.
Payne could have been there.
Yeah.
Osiris' disciple. You know, he could have been there for the meeting. Like, Pen, you go handle this real quick while we do other and
that's,
you know.
I just love just Mel's saying. Response. Mel's response, oh, Christ.
it's literally, I hear you, but I think Osiris would have sent someone not imaginary.
Well, and I mean, I know.
I'm just saying, one day they're going to drop the pan bomb, and everybody's going to crap their pants, and I'm going to be like, "Yes." And so, the hell made that call to pay an account? Whoever you are, I don't know who you are, but I love you, and keep doing what you're doing.
you're good people.
we will find out that you are right one day, sir. As am I.
There was a theory that I think came out on maybe the Osiris episode or the original Osiris. And it's one of my favorites. It might not have legs. It's kind of far-fetched.
but it was that this...
It's got a mohawk, though.
This person, yeah, it was that this person was actually Saint 14. It involves you believing that Saint 14 found Osiris and kind of became his like right-hand man, which is...
What do you mean he went into the demon light and he came out brighter?
Came out brighter.
Wait, go ahead. Sorry, I just thought of something. No.
That theory is just kind of... You have to make a couple of leaps in logic to espouse that theory.
There might be a dragon that you have to ride over a rainbow.
Yeah, it's not quite that. I think we can
confirm. It's obvious that it is the Saint 14 helmet that says he went into the demon light and came out. I'm being serious. I'm not being a joke around right now. He came into the demon light and he came out brighter.
Right.
That was whether or not it was Pain himself, thank you, Pain, for being there, that said it, or it's a song that is sung about Saint 14, mm-hmm. It would mean that Saint 14 went into a demon light and he came out brighter. And that would give you a reason to believe that it could possibly be Saint 14 at that meeting.
Right.
At the same time, almost every piece of Osiris gear, the Trials of Osiris I'm talking about, of course, talks about going into the darkness and then coming back to the light. Like a lot of the Trials gear hints to you went into the dark, but you came back. So, I mean, that means very easily it could mean that Osiris did the same thing himself.
Right.
As a matter of fact, I want to say one of the pieces said that he did do it himself. And we all know that Osiris was kind of like the toll end of the Vex, except he didn't let it consume him like Tolan did the Hive. And that's just my two cents.
So about those Awoken.
I know we totally got into a straight up Osiris rant right there. I'm sorry.
Got to.
But I just wanted to set it clear because, I love the joke about the whole Pain thing, but I wanted to get serious there and talk about the fact that honestly at that meeting it was probably either Osiris himself, because we do have flavor text where Eris does send an undisclosed report to Osiris in-game. And, of course, we know that this person was very bright, so bright that Eris couldn't look at him. So that person most likely was either Saint 14 or it was Osiris. And a lot of lore stuff has been hinting to Osiris, most definitely being alive. He's kind of being incognito right now.
Mm-hmm. But okay, the other fun part here is we have tech witches, which is awesome.
Oh, by the way, Blue, he killed me. Tekkun.
Yes.
I want to say that it's Tekkun.
Oh, okay.
Oh, okay.
But they have really cool jewelry.
Yeah, I was actually kind of looking, like, that part stuck in my head. Their jewel-like augments, I can't speak right now, gently hummed. And it's interesting that they call them augments, mm-hmm. You know, because I think when you are young, you know, like, okay, these are things that have helped alter them or control them. So, I mean, like, is it possible that she's able to kind of keep them in like her control with these type of augments that are there?
Oh, I mean, she does. On the same page I am. Like, hey, you have telepathy and illusion abilities. Guess what? Clip, clip. Okay, what? Now you're allowed to continue. The interesting thing about the Tekkuns are there are only seven that we know of. Three of which have been removed from the picture as far as the the Battle of Saturn, which is the opening sequence of The Taken King.
Right.
One of those, well, actually, both of those are the two that we... What was that?
I was just saying they could have went with Mara. There is that
possibility. I don't know about that. Well, anyways, the two that we actually see here is... So we see Shiro and Setia. Both of those are reported deceased at the Battle of Saturn. The other that was reported deceased was Kali, which leaves Illyn, Lissel, Nassia, and Portia. And if I remember correct, we might get a little bit more into this detail, but if I remember correctly, Kali was actually about to challenge Shiro for the Coven Mother position. And so the seven Tekkuns form what's called a Coven, which we'll talk about in a little bit here. But it's a very, very... Again, matriarchal society here. It really reminds me, I don't know how many of you are familiar with Forgotten Realms, but it kind of reminds me of the Drow in the sense that it's a very matriarchal society that's also elven. They have covens that are kind of the advisors of a royal figure, questionable moral situations, and super secret powers. So if you haven't read up on the Drow, I totally suggest the Dark Elves series. But that's what stood out for me in that card, other than the obvious awesome connection to Osiris.
Mm-hmm. And you guys say that it's theorized that the hunter standing there is Eris, right?
Yeah, there's a lot of connections. We know it's a female. We know that she doesn't have a ghost. Yeah.
She used to be a guardian.
She used to be a guardian. She no longer has a ghost. She has pale lips. You can't tell where she's looking. She can't look at the other presumable guardian standing there. Yeah. I mean, there's just, you know, her usual stony face. She has a low voice that gets very passionate when she talks about killing a certain hive figure. I mean, there's only so many hints that it takes before it really starts just being like,
yeah,
there's one figure.
I just want to make sure that we're all on the same page there, that's what we're, because that's what I was thinking. We're on the same page.
Yeah. So, and, you know, we had a figure also standing in this room that a lot of people have polarizing views on, and that would be the Queen's brother.
The Queen's brother. Top of the card says, quote, "I will not sacrifice my birthright for the promise of security." As the Queen's confidant, spy master, and deadliest enforcer, her brother wields an enormous power, particularly for a male born in the Reef's matriarchal society. Recent reports suggest he may differ from the Queen on key matters of strategy, but it remains to be seen whether this grasp is the source of conflict or part of the reason the Queen values him so highly. So it's pretty interesting. I know when the very first movie you see in vanilla with the Queen, you could definitely sense that tension between the Queen and the brother and how the brother thinks it needs to be done this very specific way. My impression of him is that he's like very much like, let's go in right away. Let's get this done. Let's get this taken care of. No, like, I don't care what it takes. No messy politics. But you can definitely tell that she's much more calculating, that she's sits back and looks at all the different pawns and pieces of the puzzle and to see what each person that comes to her has to offer and how she can use them to their advantage. You know, like, you definitely sense that in the very first cutscene you ever see of the Queen. Ever. Like that one cutscene when you go there and you start asking about, you know, the Gate Lord and all that, and just sticks in my mind so well, especially the way she just speaks very slowly, very few words, and you can see him just getting like very frustrated about how what she's saying and what she's doing. So it's to me it was really interesting to have a guy that you can tell has a lot of power and is very strong, but he's not the one that's leading. It's her. So I also like that he does
don't touch me's.
Yeah.
He does. I'm sorry. That is like, I see a picture of him. I'm like, oh my gosh, that is like your entire personality right there. Don't touch me.
You know, I always joke that like with the way how he's so like, I don't know. I get not emo, just kind of like, oh, mom, you don't understand. Like kind of attitude. Very emo. He always reminds me of Davey Havoc from AFI. Like I just call him.
Oh my God. you're correct.
So there's a little thing for you guys to digest and go
put out. I had this picture in my head. If anyone was going to play him in a movie, it'd probably end up being Jared Leto or someone just completely a container
The reason I find it other than the fact that it, you know, is kind of like what I picture his personality to be, don't touch me, is he's a spy master. Do you guys remember what the ability of that exotic armor was? You get touched, you go invisible.
It made Fraggle feel safe.
It made Fraggle feel safe.
That's the exotic perk. I still happen to be looking at Marisov quotes, and I actually have the quote from the scene Mel was talking about where she says, and I'm going to try to do the cadence of her voice. It is afraid of the fallen. It does not understand that these ones are mine. And then there's a really good one from a subsequent cutscene. It says, it has returned and it still has its ball. So why is she calling us it?
Because we're a chess piece.
Yeah. She doesn't acknowledge. She doesn't.
I mean, remember when her rebuttal from her rebuttal to her brother is often when we guess at others' motives, we reveal only our own.
Yeah, and that's an awesome quote, by the way. It seems like it's not until after we actually do the deed in the Black Garden that she starts referring to us. She refers to us as guardian. She's a little condescending.
Well,
she views us.
I mean, she literally views us as a chess piece. We just got promoted from a pawn to maybe a knight.
Listen. Let's not. You know, mesh words here. She's the queen of a floating Hooverville. Okay, she's not. Okay, this is not Paris, France. Okay. No need.
She is Marisov, and you're gonna stop disrespecting her. What's gonna happen?
Hey,
she has the harbingers, man. Like, hello, and the tension is like, why? I'm not gonna want to f with her. Like, that's pretty scary, man.
You get
that?
You tell him, Mel. You tell him right now.
I'm just very brooding, like her brother. Speaking of,
okay, Davey.
There is a very. Oh. Good ghost fragment on the queen's brother, where it actually kind of goes into the crows. Ghost fragment, queen's brother. The machine had wings and feathers, sleek and black as its body, but the feathers were eyes too, sharp and delicate, and ears that pricked at every sound. The young prince considered the machine, considered its purpose and his own. And then he called to it. I have a task for you. Obedience was woven into its workings. And so it stopped. Master of crows. Mind the Black Garden's gate. Follow anyone who passes through. In the name of your sister, the machine vowed. And it went to find its warp capsule. Just as another came in. But this one flew skittishly. As if to evade its master. The prince caught it from the air. You avoid me. I am tasked by the queen, but you serve me. He let it tremble in displeasure for a moment. Tell me your news. The machine flicked its wings. The prince stroked them flat with slow, assured motions. Tell me your news, he said again. What's the harm?
The heart is growing stronger, the crow said. The Vex transformation has begun, and the progeny are stirring. The prince considered this in silence for a moment, and then he wrapped up the crow in his fist and folded its wings around it so that it could not move or fly. He did all this swiftly and with purpose. Carrying the machine, he went to see his sister. She was alone with her fallen guards, sitting before a window with into infinity. Her eyes did not leave the universe, but sensing her brother, she said, "Yes, what is it?" "There's news to share," he said, and offered the crow in his fist. "And I think I've earned the right to share it." So yes, this is the Uldren butthurt card.
When is he not?
He did not get CC'd on the email, and he's not happy. He just wants to be in the loop.
He wants to be part of Casual Fridays, right?
Yeah, he likes Taco Tuesday as well.
Oh God!
So this actually does see they aren't on your spot on Mel with your assessment of their relationship. It's not all yes, master. You know, he is not really at one with his lot in life. You know, he would like to be considered a little bit more than he is.
Mm-hmm. I always get the sense that since he is her brother, that they should rule as one together. And I always get the sense that he's very upset and doesn't quite understand why she doesn't defer to him or share with him what is going on. I definitely feel that Mara keeps him very, 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 very far away. Like, you are in charge of this task. This is what you do. Tell me what you find, and that's all I want you to do. And I feel like, you know, it's like, but I'm the prince. Like, I should be with you. Like, we should be doing this together as one unit. And she's like, no, sweetheart. That is not how this works. So...
I'm going to have to disagree.
Well, Mel,
have to disagree.
I can see what Mel is saying.
I can see it. I just completely disagree. because you have to understand that he is the advisor. He is also the spy master and enforcer of the entire reef. So his entire purpose is the controlling of intelligence throughout the entirety of the Awoken's realm. And, you know, as such, you know, okay, so there's one important distinction to be made here as well. There are two types of crows. There are agents, the crows, and then there are the monitoring devices. They're the monitoring devices, which is what he has here. It's actually like a, you know, it's kind of like a crow, like the animal, and it obviously fits in a hand. It's enough that he can grab it, and they have these, you know, warp things. I can't remember what I just completely blanked. Warp capsules. They're surveillance devices. And so they look like crows. Their feathered wings are actually basically visual and auditory sensors, which is actually kind of cool. But there's a different type of crow. There's the agents, and we actually know another crow. It's Jolien, who some of you might remember from Prison of Elders, the exotic weapon Lord of Wolves. Jolien created that. The crows, the actual people, are members of the entire intelligence network of the reef. And that entire network is led by Uldren Sov. That's where he gets the title Master of Crows, not just the surveillance devices, but also the spies, the intelligence network, and probably other wet work duties. You know, you have covert messages, emissaries, and you probably, I mean, it would stand to reason that these are also the guys that get rid of problems. Because of that, you can't, he's annoyed. I can sense the annoyance, not so much because he wants to quote unquote rule, because remember, this is again the society that's driven by a matriarchal process. It's it's not even gonna, it probably wouldn't even be programmed into his head to think that he would ever rule. But the problem is that he can't do his job if people are keeping information from him. His entire purpose is to find out the information that's being kept from them. So when his own queen is keeping information from him, it is undermining his entire ability to protect her and to do the job that he has been assigned to the best of his duties. That's where I feel the tension's coming from, is he's like, okay, you tell me you want me to do this, but then you go off and, you know, it's like, it's almost more of like, hey, look, stop being the spoiled little princess that you think you are right now on this one little aspect. It's not so much a power struggle as much as it's like, I can't protect you and do what you need me to do if you won't let me do what I need to do. Right?
Yeah, I yes. can definitely see it, Lou.
I can see that.
Chen still feels like Ulgin's making a play for power, though.
Oh, I don't think so. If he was making a play for power, he would have in the aftermath, he would not have tried as hard as he did when no one is surveying for a connection with his sister. He panics. Well,
of course, he wants Mara there. Yeah. Obviously, he wants Mara there. But like in that point, that's a completely different timeline. Like in this timeline, where this is, I want to say, before she even tried to offer Skolas to the Nine.
Yeah, this is before the Civil War.
Before all of that. So let's rewind real quick. And I mean, at this point in time where this card was at, you know, this could have been, I mean, I do agree with you at the point where Aldrin's like, hey, this is my job. At the same time, I think he respects to a point the matriarchy, if that makes sense to you.
Yeah.
And he's, you know, he's like, hey, listen, I have my bird. I know that you said that the crow shouldn't tell me, but you probably should tell me like everything right now.
No, he didn't say that to the queen. He said that to his servant.
Exactly, but
his words were, he caught it. He caught the crow, and he said, "You avoid me." And the crow's response is, "I'm tasked by the queen." And his response is, "But you serve me." So his entire problem isn't that the queen technically went around. I mean, his entire network is at the whim of the queen. That's entirely, and I don't think he argues that at all. I don't get the sense of argument in there. His entire problem is that his servants are trying to skirt around him when they should be telling him. I mean, it's entirely the intelligence network. Sidestep. Yeah, mm-hmm. That's where I think the frustration is like. He's like, no, I don't care that you're telling certain that, you know, you're telling my crows to go do stuff. That's your right. But the problem is that they're avoiding the chain of command when they come back. They don't loop me in into that information. Going off what we have access to in the game, the character of the crow does not seem to be making a play for any power other than the sense that he's trying to enable his intelligence network to be the best service to his sister as possible. I mean, can we all agree on that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think so. I still think he has just a slight, not that he thinks that he should be one of the ruling, but like, hey, I'm your advisor. I feel like you should be looping me in and then seeking me and taking my advice more instead of just like telling me to do tasks. That's how I kind of see how he's so grumpy all the time.
Yeah,
but yes. So a little bit of both.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure that's what Blue was trying to say.
A little from column A, a little from column B.
Yeah. So let's go to the aftermath, which is another view into the Queen Alderaan's, you know, personality too here. Mel, you want to grab? Do you have the aftermath pulled up real quick?
Yes, I do. Awesome. I actually pulled them all up. I'm just going to put that out there.
All right.
So, the aftermath quote: "Do not fear, brother. This was the only choice I had." The sound of her voice ripped him from sleep. He jumped up. His ship was still contained in its protective sphere. He tried to react. I can't speak at the moment. He tried to retract the shield, but it was locked to its initiation time. He couldn't remember activating it. Then he remembered the battle, that blast. What the ship fired was ancient, not bound to anything the origin libraries even sought to describe. He tried to calm down. He thought of her, searching for her pole, but he couldn't find it. But he was not calm. She always told him she would always be there behind the calm. All he could hear were echoes of that sound. It began as soon as they hit the ring plane, ringing in the old glimmer of his long buried self, before she showed him who he was, in the before and the after. The tycoons should have known that a dreadnought could do, must have known. Did they not feel what he felt, hear what he heard? And that damn catch, it wasn't protected. They had to have known that. All to deploy the harbingers. They barely got a foothold before the weapon was fired. He thought of Petra and how overwhelmed she must be, forced to hold her posts and watch her people perish. He tried to calm himself, forcing long breaths. He realized where he was. Mars. Athabasca. The Candor Isles. He hadn't been here long, so not since he found the Black Garden. The countdown to the shield's deactivation pulse. He tried again. To home in on her. To find if she truly gave herself for this battle. He felt close to something. A hum of starlight. Then shield deactivation broke his focus. He climbed out and saw the damage of his ship. The truths of the Armada's devastation sunk in. He turned in despair to find hundreds of Crow's drones deployed on Mars long ago circling his ship, waiting. "Welcome back, Master," the one closest to him spoke first, and the others followed. A wave of salutations echoed through the dry sea, and with that hope returned. "Bring repairs to the ship immediately. Something has gone missing, and you will help me find it." So, yeah. I'm going to assume that this is the whole entire time right after the dreadnought went pew, 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 and kind of took out a huge part of the Armada.
So, I also want to point out that he got his butt kicked far.
Yeah, to be honest, I have never read this Grimoire card until this very moment. And I was always under the assumption that he was also one of the ones that perished during that huge pew, pew, pew from the dreadnought. But apparently not. So he's ended up, you know, down on Mars somewhere. So that before I knew about this, again, Mel's hand canon, which is not always based in fact. This is just from the little bit of information that I have at the time, that she knew what was going on. And decided to I'm going to use my ability and I'm going to make the whole entire fleet just go scatter everywhere and save us and make it look like we were destroyed, but we're not really destroyed. That's just a whole JK. Mm-hmm. So,
well, and that is actually a theory too. There's a number because that nods back to the Reef Wars and the Tetune's illusion.
And it wouldn't make sense if you think back to that, the previous card and how Mara was sending Crows out to go do things and he was kind of like, hey, what the hell? It would then make some sense that when he finally came to and he's realized where he was, he has these Crows around him with all this information. And it could be possible that Mara sent all these Crows to him. It's like, hey, this is what's going on. I know I didn't tell you at the moment and this is why. So, but
I also really want more information on the origin libraries.
Yeah. Yeah. Are these...
That is absolutely necessary.
Yeah.
It makes me think of the Awoken's version of the World's Grave. Basically.
Yeah.
I could see that.
But yeah.
So the origin I libraries are something that you think the God, I can't even think of the word. I don't know. Stuff, reasons, things.
Well, the reason why is because he says when the ship fired, what that ship fired, you know, speaking of the dreadnought, was ancient.
Yeah.
Not bound to anything the origin libraries even sought to describe. So this is, you know, this is obviously, we know from the Books of Sorrow that the dreadnought is, you know, eras in age, you know, like it's in, and Oryx is obviously millennia, you know, and so this is something that has existed before any of us, as far as we know. There's a couple theories that we're not going to get into on that, but the fact is that the origin libraries aren't even seeking to describe something that could be potentially bound to something that would explain what that was. I mean, mm-hmm. this is to put into your, you know, this is to describe to the reader the scope of the difference that the Hive have when compared to us and the Awoken and the Exos and the human. I mean, we are a mere blips on the timeline compared to the Hive. And but that being said, you know, what are the origin libraries? Are those part of the you know, libraries of Hygieia that were destroyed? I mean, it doesn't seem like it. It seems like they're still, you know, accessible, which also would point to a theory that the libraries of Hygieia are not actually destroyed. But what are they? I want them, is basically my response. I would also like more information on everything. But yeah. Well,
yeah. In time. In time.
That's not broad.
You have all. Not.
I just want more information on everything.
Yeah. So, but yeah, I mean, that's like one of the big things that stands out for me in this card is the origin libraries.
More information on everything?
Yes.
I think we all do at this point, Blue.
Yes.
Like,
I would like more pieces of the puzzle.
We all would. Like, there's so much yet to be explained to Destiny. And in each topic, it's not just one topic. Like, look at us with the Awoken here. There's so much that we have, and at the same time, there's so much we don't have. Like, it's so torn, and I can't wait till they actually flesh this all out.
Yeah.
Personally.
Now, the other thing that we get here is we do get a sense of something related to the Harbingers. We do know, apparently, they can't hold up their shields when they deploy the Harbingers. Did you guys catch that?
Yes, all to deploy the Harbingers.
Yep, they barely got a foothold before the weapon was fired. And then, you know, he's like, he's thinking of Petra and how overwhelmed, you know, and all this stuff. But I'm like, you know, he also has a sense of the telepathic connection to the Queen, which seems to be every Awoken to a degree, but his is a little bit, you know, a little bit above. I kind of attribute that to a sibling connection. But I don't know, like, it just, there's so many things.
Well, you should, because he does say in a specific instance that she told him about his birth, which obviously not every Awoken remembers their birth, but she remembers hers, and she remembered his.
Which also
filled him in on that.
Right, which also begs the question of if they're biologically actually related.
I've always wondered that. If they're actually
brother and sister,
you know, brother and sister by DNA, by blood, or if they are brother and sister in the sense of from when they were Awoken.
Right.
And it's hard to tell right now.
So one thing that was always, that's interesting for me is the very first line of this card, the sound of her voice ripped him from sleep. Is that to allude that he was dreaming? And all of a sudden her voice came into him in a dream? Or is she actually in another dimension or part of the world that actually is like, hey, hey, wake up, wake up, wake up. It's time for you to wake up. Like, do the thing, you know, because they do have that connection. And, you know, like if that connection is as strong as we think it is it possible that she is still some other place and she's relying on that psychological or psychic connection with her brother to let him know, like, hey, you know, it's okay. Like, I know you don't know where I'm right now, but I'm, you know, so far away that the connection is not as strong as normal. And therefore this is all I can tell you. So, because that obviously the very first quote, the only do not fear brother, this is the only choice I had. This is something that would have been told to him after the fact. So either he's imagining it and it's in a dream that he had, or she is still alive and letting him know after the fact, like, this is what's going on. Like, I'm sorry, this is the choice I made, and I'm sorry I'm going to make you worry about me, but, you know, things had to be done. So.
Well, I'll say I completely with you greatly, Mel. I understand where you're trying to come from. It definitely seems like she is the matriarch, as we've been discussing. That's what the whole Awoken race seems to go to, is the matriarch. She is the queen. Well, specifically the Reefborn. So she rules all. And then we have, of course, Aldrin here. And that card you just read, it screams kind of desperation almost to try to reconnect with her. If not desperation, you know. And it shows how much he depends on her.
Yeah.
You know, he definitely feels like he needs Mara in his life, or it's not going to be complete. But most importantly is the fact that he feels like he can find her, because, you know, he's like, he tells the crows to build the ship.
Find something that is lost. And it's he doesn't say, like, oh, we have terrible news, we need to let everyone else know. He's like, oh, something is lost, we need to find it. So to me, that kind of just like, hey, all right, we know she's around somewhere, but we have no clue. So, and that was kind of the point.
Mm-hmm.
So do you want me to read the coven card?
Yeah, I was going to say, you know, we talked, there's been a couple mentions of these mysterious creatures.
Yes.
Called the Tetuans, and those, yeah,
the Tetuans, so, sir,
Tetuans,
whatever.
All right,
these Tetuan witches.
All right, I'll go ahead and read the coven. Maybe I shouldn't be reading this. On the eve of war, the chamber was dark. The seven of them were rarely in a room together anymore, but this was the eve of their greatest journey, a plan that overcame death and spanned universes. They were all connected in trance, communing as the ancients did. Speaking would trip their hand to the Harbinger's mind they kept here, trophies from an Aegis war and weapons in the right hands. Quote, Oryx could kill her if she holds on too long, Sedia offered through the silence, fearing that was to come. We took an oath long ago, obedience even in the face of defeat, Naskia dispensed fear. Only a defeat here, now, not there, then. Ilion wandered between the two sides of the three. The amulet around her neck marked Ilion as the coven's mother, granting her visions beyond the veil, places only the queen could go. So we hope. Kali had long sought the power of the amulet, but the Tetuans are taught not to desire. Our queen awaits. Lysiel? Is that how you pronounce her name? Lysiel? Attempted to end the challenges. There was little time in a war to fight. So now the decision is nigh. The Harbingers, which to prepare. Sura was determined to see this all through. Excitement was taught to be kept at bay. We cannot send them all, Portia reminded. All but one, the oldest. It stays with us. Sedia, Kali, Shiro, take the children. Tell her they are to be planted into a dead thing to have children of their own. A plan hid behind Lillian's eyes, but Tetsuans do not share their eyes with others. What if they are not wise enough for the dreadnought? Ilian turned back to the source. Sidia, do you not have faith in our queen?
So much information.
So much information that actually causes more questions than it answers. So.
So.
I sense Blue, you're just like waiting.
Oh my God.
Waiting to get in.
Tech witches. Right, tech witches are so cool. Okay, so I misspoke a little bit. Shiro was not the coven mother. Ilian has always been the coven mother. We get confirmation here that one of the augments that they have is an amulet. Now, the information on that amulet is somewhat vague, but we do know that, first off, amulet marks the coven mother. Second off, it actually allows them to pierce the veil where normally only the queen can go. So there's a nod there that the queen has powers above that even of the normal or even super normal awoken. And the coven basically are the keepers of the harbingers, which I'm not even going to start on that conversation right now. But the fun thing about the tech witches, as I love calling them, is the just nod to actual witchcraft. They have a coven. They keep their numbers to a number of, you know, very nuanced meanings, seven. They won't meet each other's eyes. Now, that doesn't sound like a big thing, but anybody, and the only reason this stands out to me is because I've been rereading the Dresden Files, and this is a huge thing with a lot of, like, I want to say like modern / postmodern fantasy, is the importance of the eyes. And even in some, you know, historical fantasy stuff like that, not historical fantasy, but like true fantasy and other universes, the importance of connection via the eyes, because remember, the eyes are usually viewed as windows of the soul. When you're talking about a magic user, that is a very important thing. It's almost as important as knowing a thing's full name or true name. In the reason that it reminds me of the Dresden Files is because I think it's called seeing. When a wizard or a witch or a warlock or any of the magic users meet the eyes of another, they actually see the real person within those eyes, and it's seared into their brain. They can't forget it. That's kind of how I get the sense here. They don't look at each other's eyes. And if you actually look at the Grimoire card for these, for the coven especially, you'll notice that their headdresses actually cover their eyes. They literally do not meet eye to eye with anything. You also get the sense that the coven is trained and imbibes them, well, not imbibes, imprints upon them the sense of calmness, which we just got done talking about in the Aftermath card, you know, where he's like, I'm seeking the calmness because she will be there behind the calmness. This is another sense of that meditative state where they can actually access their magical capabilities, which, you know, we don't know the source of that. Could that be because of the augmentations that they have, or are those augmentations, you know, like what we were talking about, a control chip? Not really sure. We do know that at least one of the augmentations, the pendant, allows one of them, which now we know that another one, Kali sadly, conveniently died, but There's a power struggle even within the coven. You know, they're taught not to desire. This sounds like a Jedi council type thing. But when we also know that they train other awoken, we will talk about that when we get to Petra, because Petra is actually a student of the coven. I'm trying to think anything else that just shouts. You know, the information on the Harbingers, we can go probably hours on this. I'm not even going to touch the Harbinger thing.
Because literally,
we could end up going hours on that.
the first part of the card, they said their greatest journey, a plan that overcame death and spanning universes. That's kind of interesting and leads more to the possibility that they're not actually dead. They're somewhere else. They're in another universe. They're wherever.
Maybe an ascended place.
It could be, just because it's a plan that overcame death, you know, death, but they're not actually death. They just made it appear that way. So, and it would be a great journey if they actually figured out how to become ascended. So.
The other thing that, you know, strikes me is, so we know that they have a plan to overcome death, right? We also know from some of the ghost fragments that the Awoken are born to the sound of singing. Well, we have another figure in another race that transcends death via singing.
Really?
I mean, you know, it's like, you know, it's just the
there's a lot of parallels.
There's tons of parallels. We do get confirmation that Harbingers have sentience here as well. Because of the second paragraph, there is a thing called a Harbinger mind that they keep that would assume it assumes that it controls, and the information that we have for the Harbingers really is that they're trophies from an ancient ageless war. You know, an ageless war is a war without end, which we've also referred to before. And they could be weapons in their right hands, which begs the question, are they necessarily weapons, or are they like the Vex? Are they just being used as weapons when they're actually technically for something else?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think the latter is probably.
Yeah, I do too as well.
Yeah. Yeah.
They're something incredibly ancient that we use as what? Well, they use as weapons.
Yeah, I mean, I know, and they refer to them as children because they need to be planted into a dead thing to have children of their own.
I think they're still ancient, and they're just children relative to the other Harbinger.
You know, I have. Oh, Lord. I just made a really weird connection. And I'm looking up something to confirm it. So, keep talking. I'll be right back.
There's... I've been rereading this card over and over again and digesting a little bit of more information. But I noticed earlier, obviously, that there's so many parallels between the Awoken and parts of the Hive that it's crazy. like Blue just said, the singing, and to me, the fact that the Hive are also a matriarchal society is really interesting, and then the Awoken are a matriarchal society. So it makes me wonder, like, what parts of the darkness have granted certain abilities that you see here. So with the Awoken.
Okay.
Yeah. It's strong parallel.
Yeah. Creepily so, like unsettling. So, you know, like not.
Well, I can remember when I first read that card where the witch, before I was aware of the coven and all everything else, I just remember reading that card with the queen, and it says that the witch with the glowing eyes was behind her. And I was like, ah, collusion. You're clearly in bed with the Hive. And I was like, oh, but you have your own witches. Okay, never mind. That's not near as interesting.
So,
but yeah, there are parallels to be had. What do you got, Blue?
Oh, there's so many connections. Okay, so on the first connection that I was actually just looking at, if you take the comment about, and this is going to be the last bit of my Harbinger descent into madness, and these are all theories, so this is nothing like super well grounded in anything other than just my brain connecting a few random quotes. But it says, tell her that they are to be planted into a dead thing to have children of their own. So first off, that for some odd reason, that made me think of Xur. And we know that Xur was... there's a comment from Xur that we get, and he says, "We came up from the dust and burrowed into flesh for warmth and became something new. But it was the nine," and then another quote that says, "But it was the nine who gave us purpose, and it was the nine who kept us whole." And then he keeps talking about like how they came up and they burrowed into things and they became something new. And there's a potential connection right there. I don't really know where that was going other than a connection to Xur, and he is technically a Jovian, which is around this area. But then there is a even more interesting connection to, again, so remember, plant the children into a dead thing to have children of their own. If you remember back in Books of Sorrows, verse 1-3, the oath, Sithona, who becomes later Savathun, has an oath, and she says, "I will take back my home and eat the mother jelly. I will raise my spawn on the corpse of the Helium King." So literally, she will raise her children on a corpse, you know, like planting a child in a dead thing so that it can be raised to have children of its own. We also know that later Savathun actually hides within the dragons and will, you know, embed agents within other living things to hide among a race. And I think that's the Harmony, if I remember that off the top of my head. So there's a lot of connections with the Harbinger and Savathun, and maybe even a connection with Xur and the Jovians a little bit, depending on how far down the rabbit hole you want to go with that. So, like I said, that's going to be where I leave the Harbinger madness, because otherwise I'll be here for hours.
Yeah. Do you want to talk about the Awoken Guard?
Yeah, we can talk about the Awoken Guard, you know, to break me from my madness.
No, just because there's another class title in the Awoken hierarchy we haven't really talked about.
Oh, that is, yeah, that's, yep.
Paladin.
Paladins.
Paladin. So paladins are like military commanders in the Awoken scheme of things. In all military matters, the queen's commands are carried out by her seven paladins. Again, the number seven. Four command the royal armada, including the Corsairs and the Vestian Guard. These are Abrazir, Kamala Rior, Hallam Finn, and Leona Brill. Two command the Royal Army, including the Reef's battle stations and military installations. That's Pavel Nolg and Devi Kasi. And then the seventh paladin commands the Royal Awoken Guard, whose primary task is to safeguard the queen in any and all matters. This includes threats not only to her person, but to the Reef as a whole. As such, the Royal Awoken Guard work closely with the Queen's brother, the Master of Crows, Prince Aldrin Sov, and every Guard member is trained in espionage and diplomacy, as well as in firearms and hand-to-hand combat.
I do want to very quickly update that listing. We had a couple who died in the Taken King.
There's a vacancy, is there not?
There's a vacancy, if you would. So of the four that lead the Royal Armada, Armada, which is basically the Space Fleet, the Corsairs, and the Vestian Guard, which is all the ships that fly around and patrol. Of that, only Hallam Finn and Kamala Rior are left alive. Abra and Leona both died in the Battle of Saturn. And there is actually another one, Imogen Rife, who we learned of from the Reforged. There's actually a weapon named after Imogen. In the Royal Army, which is basically the soldiers, the battle stations, and the military installations, the only paladin left alive is Devi Castle. Pavel actually died as well in the Battle of Saturn. And then that brings us to the actual Royal Awoken Guard, Yasmin Eld. Well, you guys might recognize Yasmin. They're dead. And we actually have a sniper rifle named after them from the Taken King or the King's Fall raid. So
yes, she was defiant.
Yes, which I mean makes sense. But yeah, I mean that's my only update, and that was simply because this card was added in the House of Wolves, and so those updates were from the Taken King.
But I don't think we've ever actually seen a paladin.
Unless not
want to count Petra as the seventh paladin.
Yeah, but she's not. She's the Queen's Wrath.
Well, no, is she still in Taken King?
Yeah. Well, yes.
By Petra? Time,
yeah, she's still considered the Queen's Wrath.
But doesn't she command the Royal Awoken Guard?
Let me make sure
I'm just making sure she's not wearing two hats.
Well, she kind of is, because she's
trying to make sure we haven't seen a paladin in game. That's what
she is the acting regent.
Because if it's not her, the answer
is
no.
Yeah, she's the acting regent. So she basically is, taking, okay. So she takes over as the acting regent commander. Yeah. Yeah. Which is causing a lot of strife because the tech witches don't really like her, or they don't report well to her. And then Varix is trying to assassinate her and, you know, all that fun stuff.
So that kind of covers that. I think the Prison of Elders is kind of its own thing.
Yeah, I mean, the note from the Prison of Elders that we should bring in here is really that it's an enigma even within the Reef because of the nature of the prisoners that are being kept there. Not only just being kept prisoner there, but also who are actually being tested on, as we learned from the Taken King, the April update, because the tech witches and Varix are kind of poking around the Taken, trying to figure out how they're getting their powers, which gives you kind of a sense that they're doing that with the other, which would make sense. You study your opponents. But yeah, that was really the point of the Prison of Elders. There's not really anything super that we haven't already talked about. The Prison of Elders, the Reef card, is Cade Six's view of it, and basically reiterates that the Queen is really good at politics. I think that was really the basic information that you get there. At the very end, he says, "Whatever happens, I want you to remember that she knows more than anyone else I've met how to set one foe against another." So she makes Machiavelli look like a bumbling child. I'm trying to think, did we have any other we have Silver. I'm trying to think. The cool thing about Silver was that it was engram-like qualities, but they were coins, which basically is a really cool little trick. They could be digitally signed with an individual person's key. So like a piece of silver, you could actually personalize it in a way. Because remember, engrams are programmable matter, like glimmer, but it's, you know, so that was really the cool thing. And we know the Grimoire card for silver confirms that the reef had settlements before the collapse. So there was that information dropped as well.
We're probably early dead orbit members.
Well, no, because the factions wouldn't have existed before the collapse necessarily. And also I would view them more as researchers, because remember, you have Clovis Bray pushing out on Mars. We have the supposed location of the Deepstone Crypt on Europa, which is in that area. I mean, you're researchers, and then you also have the entire concept of engrams and glimmer and all this other stuff that was coming about at the Golden Age. So it would make sense that the Hygieia libraries, which seem to be the repository of all the cryptarch's information, would be the maybe birthplace of the engram, which we know that one of the Bray members actually created the engram. I'm trying to remember off the top of my head. I think it was Elsie. I'm wanting to say that was who it was. Give me one second. But I want to say it was Elsie Bray that made up the concept of it. But yes, the Brays were all over this stuff. I can't find it at the top at the moment. Yeah. I want to say it was Elsie. I want to say, but yeah. Sorry, like I'm scrambling over here. I'm like, I know I've seen this. It was Elsie or Willa, I think. It was one of the two of them. Willa. Dr. Willa Bray. From In Good Temper, which is one of the quests, says the unique datastatic structure of relic crystals inspired Dr. Willa Bray to develop the first engram matter encryption techniques during the Golden Age. So, again, another connection to the Bray family. Which, you know, hopefully we're going to be getting some information on them in Rise of Iron. I think that's all been confirmed, that we're getting more Clovis Bray information dropped. So I'm looking forward to getting that. Other than that, we talked about the reframes and about how they just confirmed the obsession with secrets.
It's worth noting that the Awoken's frames are the only ones we've seen carry weapons.
Yeah, which actually kind of makes me sad, because the frames would seem like, you know, I know there's a lot of hearsay about the original purpose of the frames being like a military police force within the tower. I think that would have been pretty cool, because it would have made sense. But,
well, it makes more sense out in the reef, because it's the Wild West. I mean, the tower's a lot more secure than, say,
yeah, but it's so weird because the reef frames are scrubbed so they don't get personalities. Like, I don't know.
Yeah, because you don't want the
well, yeah, that's fair enough.
Personality.
That's true.
Have you watched the
Yeah, no, short? I know. I realize that's where you're going with that, yeah. I'm not sure I have any. Oh, I did have a note on the Akia Waits cinematic that we were talking about, where she calls the ghost a ball. I did have a note there the dialogue kind of hints that the Awoken are not fully aware of the range of the transmat abilities that the ghost has. Because if you remember that whole thing, there's an entire piece when you come back from killing the Gate Lord, there's an entire conversation where they're like, oh, you didn't do it. You know, a coward running away is a valid strategy, ignoring the cowardice of it. And then the ghost is like, oh, no, we killed one. And then he transmats the head. Both of them act surprised. They are not it kind of seems like they're not fully they know what the ghost is, but they don't know the full capabilities of a ghost, which makes sense because they're not, you know, in the tower or anything like that. So there are things that they do not know is my point on that one. Other than that, I'm trying to think.
That's interesting because I never read that situation that way. I always read it that they were like, you know, trash talking and like, oh, you didn't do it. And then you showed proof and they're like, oh, snap. Oh, snap. We need a word. That's how I always read that. They're like, oh, they actually brought it. Wow. You just put us in our place.
Well, like, so I'm going to pull the transcript just real quick. Because it's like, it says the guardian enters the queen's throne room and, you know, that's the whole, it's alive and it still has its ball. And then Aldrin's the whole, it's, there's no shame right away. They exchange looks of confusion when the guardian responds, we didn't run. And then she asks Aldrin, was no Gate Lord slain, brother? And he says, oh, we slayed a Gate Lord. And then that's when you transmat the Vex head into the throne room. And there was this kind of like, And then they, you know, they kind of quickly go into the like, oh, they don't even know where it is, blah, blah, blah. And, you know, all that little kind of thing. But the confusion and then the kind of the sense of, oh, you can do that is what I was kind of going off of there.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, it almost, yeah, I can read that as a taunt, but I don't know, like, I can see that, yeah. But that's not how I perceived it, so.
And then, instantly, Aldrin becomes Microsoft technical support. Yeah, this one doesn't work, you need a new Gate Lord head. Didn't even bother to tell you there's a kiosk on Mars where you can power it up and be just fine.
So is he, like, is he Clippy? Is he not Clippy?
Yeah, he's Clippy. Are you writing a resume? No, Clippy. No. No one's writing a resume. You writing a resume? No, Clippy, be quiet. Okay.
It's my job. I'm supposed to know all the information. I need to know this.
Yeah.
Let me help you.
Clippy.
Yeah, I mean, the only other note that I have here is the coven's power is not connected to the traveler, which I mean, we kind of already talked about that. And as far as like the chat ideas from chat and all that, there was a lot of discussion on the queen, which is really not surprising given how much of an amazing character she is. There was a bit of chat on the Harbingers, obviously, again, just because of the interest in there. I do want to see. I don't think we missed any. There was some debate on whether or not Eris Morn is an Awoken. We don't know what race she is, simply because she is really, 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 really pale. The argument there is that her reference to Mara as her queen, could be a nod to her being an Awoken, which is, I mean, it's a very small connection, but there was that conversation. As far as from Reddit, I did get into a conversation with Captain Kex. We were talking about there has been a repeated claim that the Awoken Guardians on Earth is from a scrapped storyline. That is false. And we kind of talked about that. Basically, numerous employees and Deej himself have repeatedly just come out and been like, no, this is not the case. That was really the only unique thing there was a really interesting conversation about the communication patterns of the Awoken as far as the telepathic blending of technology and the Queen's ability to communicate with all the Awoken. But it got really, really detailed really fast. And I think we kind of touched on that with the brother card. So I think actually that brings me to the point where I'm going to say, I think we got most of what we talked about.
Nice.
That's a lot of stuff. I feel like there's a lot more.
And here's the thing is, this is only the tip of the iceberg, as yes. You know, with pretty much every other conversation we've had.
I feel like, though, like, since the Awoken are such an interesting combination of two forces, that up until you come to the Awoken, it's either you're on this side or this side. Like, there's, you don't really get to choose too much, you know, in terms of, you know, like, especially from a Guardian's point of view. Mm-hmm. And like with the Awoken, since they are possibly a key to resolving this whole entire age-old conflict, that there's just, I just feel like at some point we might get a lore drop like the Book of Sorrows in terms of like all this other information, like how long have they actually been around? Like, they have been around as you know, obviously not as long as the Hive, because they weren't aware of the technology and the dreadnought, but you know, like,
well, and we know that the Awoken, well,
it was,
unless you're talking about like a spiritual possession of some kind,
mm-hmm.
like something beyond that inhabited the physical body of them, because we know, like, biologically the Awoken have only been around since the collapse, right? We
right,
know
yeah.
that they physically have only been there for that point. But I could totally see that being an argument of possibly, you know, I'm going back to the first comments that we were talking about with the Awokens being an engram. You know, part of the decryption of the Awoken problem is the realization that maybe there's something older within them.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Maybe they are harbingers.
Possible.
Which is why the Queen can possible. Command them.
Harbingers of the Nine.
Oh God.
They,
well, and I mean, the harbinger. An harbinger is a, you know, what, like, a literally herald. A harbinger is a herald of what, of something coming. So
something that announces
usually
the coming
associated
of
with
else.
Death.
Yeah.
Right.
I mean, it. Yeah, death or war.
Yeah.
It's usually not a positive thing.
Well,
otherwise you would use the word herald.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, Kell of the House of Wolves even referred to Mara as two dead souls too. So, you know, like, is that point, like, were they actually, like, you know, a dead entity of darkness and a dead entity of light that now came together and poof, now awoken, or like, yeah. Thanks.
Yeah. No, sorry.
Let's wrap it up instead.
Yeah. Sorry. We're going to get down the harbinger path. So dangerous.
Yes.
Yeah.
Don't do it.
So yes, let's go to shout outs. Mel, why don't you take the point of honor and lead us?
Oh, you always make me do the point of honor on shout
outs. Well, she gets the point of honor, but I get the conch. And get
don't start this me. Argument again.
Okay. Not while we have company, please.
Oh geez, am I even really company anymore at this point? Like,
no, you're family.
Oh, okay.
You kick your shoes off.
I don't go from company to family. Okay, so that means I can like start eating the food out of your refrigerator now, right?
Yeah, twice.
Without asking, I know where the water cups are without having to go, hey, where's your cup? Mm-hmm. Like, I'm at that level now.
Yes. Just don't touch Willy's full throttle.
Oh, no.
And you're
no,
okay.
No, that's bad. Well, first, like always, thank you so much, guys, for letting me be here and talk about lore and kind of ride with big kids. I feel so special anytime I get to talk about Destiny stuff. Thank you again so much. Big shout out to Belle. I wish she could have been here because I follow her on Twitter and I really was really looking forward to like talking to her and kind of like getting to know her on like, I don't know, better. I don't know. So I hope you're okay and I hope everything's going well. Everyone that's going to Destiny Con, have a ton of fun because I can't be there. So like either play a Crucible match for me or pour a drink out for me or something because this Guardian cannot attend. So, but
this year.
Yeah, this year. Next year is a completely new ballgame, guys. So anyways, and if you guys are interested in anything I do costumes and stuff. So I know Blue's probably going to put all that information on the info about the podcast. And if you guys like watching costume stuff being made, I'm actually working on a Mars soft costume right now and I've been streaming it on Twitch. So that's a thing.
Amazing.
That's all I have.
That's all you got? All right. Well, I wanted to give a big shout out to our, what we call our mental cartography team, which basically is the team that puts together all the mind maps that we tag on to the show notes and which actually kind of gives a sense of what was discussed in the chat during the week. It's got hyperlinks, it's got descriptions, they're starting to color code these things. It's gotten pretty crazy and that it makes our job so much easier and just blows me away every time I try to get in there and help them. And I'm like, wow. So thank you guys again for the amazing job. Green-Eyed, Coed, and Unisys, you know, those are the three names off the very top of my head that come to mind. Also, the Destiny Community Con convention, again, I'm looking forward to meeting everyone. Mm-hmm. That's why we are recording this a day early, is so that we can be awake to get on the plane at 5 a.m. to make sure that we get out there on time. So we are really looking forward to that. We are going to probably be hanging out with the Guardian Radio guys. We'll probably be around that area of the convention most of the time. Stalk us and come give us a hug. You'll probably recognize us. We might have a t-shirt or two on that will let you know who we are. That's pretty much what I got for right now.
I really hope that you guys have cookies in the shape of enigrams at the table. I'm just saying.
Oh my gosh, that's ingenious.
Or just cookies like strange coins.
Either or. I just want that.
You're gonna go engram. It's gotta be cream filled.
Well, but engrams always disappoint you, and I don't.
True. So it's gonna be a cookie that looks really delicious, but then you're gonna eat it, and this is not gonna be delicious.
Yeah.
It's gonna be really hard.
I don't want to ruin cookies.
And then the gold ones will have toothpaste on the inside. Just a quick note on the mental cartography team. Those guys are wicked smart. So good job, Hughes. And I'd like to give a big shout out to Mel, not only for joining us tonight to talk Awoken and stay up way too late with us, but also for other things, which we will talk about later. Sorry, just...
You're welcome. Also, it's only 11 o'clock here, so it's not that late for me.
Oh, okay, well, just brag about it, why don't you?
Hey, guess what, it's only 11 here.
It's 1:09 for me, but I would like to just say echo what Mel said. Sorry Belle couldn't make it. It's always a fun time when she's on, And
it shall happen.
Also, yeah, yeah. Mel follows Belle on Twitter, but I will be following Belle in Tampa. But she can't get away then. It's not that easy. Yeah, and then just a big shout out to my clan, DoD Shadow White crew, and all the people that I hope to meet at Destiny Community Con. It's going to be great.
Can't wait. That's it.
And also, big shout out to live chat. Thanks a lot, guys.
With that, we'll begin to wrap the chat up. Thank you again to those over on Twitch for coming to spend your evening with us. If you'd like to join us, please be sure to give us a follow over on twitch.tv/focusfirechat. Links to all our sites can also be found with our episode archives on www.focusfirechat.com. Thank you again to Mel for taking the time out of your busy schedule to join us tonight. We're really looking forward to having you back again when we can get your schedule synced up with ours.
Yep.
Yes, it's in the works. It shall happen. Please be sure to email us at focusfirechat@gmail.com with any feedback or questions concerning the podcast, and let us know how we're doing by giving us some feedback on iTunes or through email as well. We try to keep to the scheduled Wednesday night streams of the chat, starting at approximately 10 p.m. Central, but if we have any variations, we always make sure to let everyone know through our Twitter account, @FocusFireChat. Also, please be sure to check out our partner podcast within the Guardian Radio Network over on theguardiansofdestiny.com. So, until next time, focus your fire, and may your light shine bright.